meeting with Podcamp, where you have this illustrious panel to talk about podcasting. We are live streaming on YouTube, and everybody can check out the video afterwards on the Podcamp site and Podcamp Facebook and everything like that. I want to gauge from how many people here have been to Podcamp? Oh, we got some newbies. So basically, Podcamp Pittsburgh is a two-day unconference talking about social media, podcasting, blogging. The 11th one is coming up this year, officially August 13th and 14th, down at Point Park University. And these events are kind of like a side thing to do throughout the rest of the year because, you know, podcasting's always happened, things are always changing. And, you know, it'd be good to kind of touch base with everybody every once in a while and you know, kind of grow things and you know, make people aware of everything more than just in August. And there's a lot of podcasting happening, holy cow, as you can see it by our panel here. And there are so many other people on the maybe list for this as my backups. Like, that's, I love this. 5 years ago, I couldn't tell you five other podcasts than me here in Pittsburgh. And I can't even tell you how many are out there right now. It's so awesome. So I thought this was a perfect opportunity to do something like that. And I have notes for everything, so I don't miss anything. We also are doing sessions, boot camps at the Beachview Carnegie Library. Yeah, there's a lot of construction over there right now, but still come out. It's a really nice library. They just renovated the place over there, including actually Amanda over here with Bold Pittsburgh is going to be doing intro to blogging next Wednesday. If anybody's interested in that. And we've been doing the intro to social media, intro to podcasting. The intro to podcasting from last month is actually a Facebook Live on our Facebook page, if you want to go back and watch that as well. I have to give a shout out to our sponsors. First of all, thanks to Work Hard Pittsburgh, this wonderful facility here. If you don't know, it's a co-working facility, slash incubator, slash there's a podcast studio downstairs. I don't know. Is that what's the rest of the laundry list?
There's a wireless mesh networking company. There's a big green screen, large format printer.
If anybody wants to take a tour afterwards, just ask Buzzy or I, and we'll take you show you all the cool stuff in the basement.
It looks like a club, but it isn't.
Anyways. Also, shout out to a friend, affiliate of that is Academy Pittsburgh, just opened up across the street and down a little bit. They're a coding academy, so if anybody is interested in and looking for a new career, if you know somebody that kind of wants to code, is not sure, and it's a nice 8-10 week course, really intensive, 12-week course, and then the big idea. I don't know, it's a lot of weeks. last time they have scholarships and everything, they're mid-session now, just announced a new one. So if you're interested in that, just look up Academy Pittsburgh, I believe it's academypgh.com. Also, shout-outs to Pittsburgh Podcast Network. They provided, Frank Mergy in the back there is the food line extraordinaire. and got all the grub for you guys tonight, so big thanks to that. And actually, I got a shout out because Allentown, people don't know a lot of stuff in Allentown. A lot of stuff is local here. Black Forge Coffee is right down the way. And what's the pizza place up here?
Paisanos.
Paisanos, right?
Paisanos. Which is peasant. That means peasant.
Yeah.
Why something good come from the hood?
That's it.
Cool stuff happening up here in Allentown. We got a really cool diner just opened up a little bit ago. It's really cool. I work out of here as well, so I'm coming up here too. So somebody's calling me and my notes went away. Also, shout out to our friends TEDx Pittsburgh. They're having an event at Soldiers and Sailors Memorial Hall, May 22nd. And the tickets are available now. A really cool, is everybody heard of TED in here, right? It's a big conference with a lot of really cool keynotes and a lot of really cool Pittsburgh. And I've attended a couple of TEDx's here in Pittsburgh, including their former TEDx Grandview in the past. And you look up TEDx Pittsburgh, TEDx Grandview Avenue at TED.com, you can see a lot of probably familiar faces up there. That's all the plugs. So who the heck are these people? Hi. I'm Mike Sorg. I'm run Sorgatron Media, also a co-organizer with Podcamp Pittsburgh. I've been doing podcasting since about 2006, and other fun social media things. Wrestling Mayhem Show is the big one. AwesomeCast, and I do a lot of stuff with clients, including Fishing Without Bait. Baja SAE is a cool collegiate competition we just started working with. And other social media, video work, I've done some documentaries and everything. Work with a lot of local pro wrestling, actually, with their video production. But I'm not the important one here. Let me just go down the line. First of all, Buzzy, just tell us who you are and kind of what is your podcast and like kind of what is your angle on podcasting. So I know we have podcasters and we have podcast networks represented up here. So just kind of real quick pitch.
I run Epicast TV, one half of it, and we do multiple different podcasts, everything from Oxford doctorate that debunks historical myths to a comedian at a strip club with other comedians. So we do a lot of different stuff. We do social good podcasts and stuff like that. So hands on everything.
Hi, I'm Katie Dudas, Dudas. A lot of people know me just as Dudas. I'm director of sales and marketing at the ScareHouse over in Edna, PA. Or Edna, obviously we're PA. Wow, my brain is mush.
it's bouncing on that ball back
there. Yeah, bouncing on the ball. I'm also part of the Sorgatron Media crew. I'm a frequent guest on AwesomeCast, Wrestling Mayhem Show. I work a lot with the ScareHouse Podcast. I've come into it within the last half, majorly in the last 6 months. But I was an infrequent guest there, but it kind of pushed it to the forefront of interest for the ScareHouse.
Jim Krenn, radio personality here for a lot of years, and the last 3 years started a podcast with my friends, Frank Mergy and Dave Settlemyer. It's called Jim Krenn No Restrictions. I do a morning show I did for a quarter century, and I'm on the radio still, but I had a 3-year hiatus, and I was unceremoniously fired. And, it was a blessing because then I discovered podcasting, and it was reminded me of radio when I started. It was like, and that's what No Restrictions came from, non-corporate, no restrictions, and great, great creative field, and I love it. So we've been doing it for 3 years now, and yeah, I think it's fun, a lot of fun. Honored to be here too, thanks for inviting me.
I'm Professor Buzzkill. I've been ruining your day since 1963. my show is a couple of weekly episodes every Tuesday and Thursday about myths and history and stuff like that, and on the Epicast Network. And Mike helps me, and everyone else here, Workhart helps me, so I'm grateful to be here as well.
I'm Brian Crawford, Pittsburgh's moral compass, your voice of reason in three rivers of chaos. I run the River's Edge Radio Network. We are a 24-hour local radio network found online at riversedgepgh.com and on the TuneIn radio app. We have, by the end of summer, we will be a 9-program network. We have 9 talk shows that will be airing in the mornings. My show right now is Mondays 6 to 8 a.m. We're actually going to be moving to Monday, Wednesday, Friday, 10 to 11 a.m. And one of the cool things about us is we are 100% local original music, no cover songs, all locally written, locally performed and recorded here in the city of Pittsburgh and in southwestern Pennsylvania. The River's Edge Radio Network, riversedgepgh.com.
He's right about the moral compass. I move this way and I feel better.
See?
Better move back. I'll bring down his average.
Good. Devil and the angel.
Come over to his dark side.
Yeah. Right.
And I believe everybody's got, just about everybody has a business card over by the coffee. The right place to put your business card.
Yes.
So if you need to catch any of us afterwards for any questions or anything. Well, so first of all, I have to get it out of the way because this is how every podcasting article that I've read in the last like year and a half has started with, podcasting's back. and I don't know, we're first time listening about podcasts or anything in this room, but a lot of us here probably have an opinion about that. And I just kind of want to ask of the panel, did podcasts go away in your eyes? What happened? Serial's a big thing. NPR's been exploding. We've been hearing about all these stories. They're talking about podcasting in the Washington Post and everything, right? Is it back or is it just a resurgence? How do you explain kind of this kind of wide idea?
I think with podcasts, especially technology, has gotten a lot simpler, because I remember when, especially when you first got into podcasting, you would tell me about it and I'd it was so complex to me in my mind. Like, I could not wrap my head around it. And to be a podcaster was huge to me. That was like this level way above wherever I could be. And now the technology is a lot easier. Like, for example, we recorded a ScareHouse podcast in the car earlier this afternoon. We just sat, we had our thing, and we take it home. I drop it on the computer, I edit it, and there it goes. And it's such an easy and simple process. And even some of the podcasts before, we recorded on our phones because maybe our original mic has a problem. We have that backup. And it still sounds the same. It's awesome that the technology is so much easier now where everybody can spread it and has access to it.
I think you're right, Kate. I think the whole thing of podcasting is that accessibility never went away. Mike, we were talking about that earlier. It's just that when a new idea hits, you know, just it's hot and it gets a niche, you know, pioneers, people to think about this, you know. But now that, you know, with the generations coming up, the millennials, and of course the new generation following with our phones and iPads and everything, we don't listen to the car radio very much anymore. I think it's not that it ever went away. I think it hit a wall. I think it's starting to get the next resurgence to get bigger and dominating. And I think that will happen when it's in the cars and commonplace, when my mom, 80-year-old Lou, can punch a button and get it in her car, which is coming. The new cars are out, as you know, with the access to do it. But as every month, 3 years, everyone has the cars and they're able to punch a button and they're able to get all of, you know, that's the cool thing about the podcast. You know, as they're following, then we get the punch of a button. The difficulty factor is the thing we're battling a little bit. I mean, people don't even want to do two processes to get something. They want one, you know, if you have to do two things. So I think, just basically repeating what you said, but it is the accessibility that makes it, I think it's getting over that wall now. It's starting to get to the thing where it's just going to just get huge, huge. I believe that.
I can't stress the drive time aspect enough. So many people tell me, oh, I love listening to the show because it's a half an hour of what I want to hear on the way to work. And so many of my new subscribers tell me that it's in the car that they listen to that, or the way home they want to decompress. So I feel sorry for, you know, radio drive time and radio morning zoo shows, but, you know, that's the way of the world.
Yeah, you see, like, all kinds of branded ads that target you and your interests specifically, and that's kind of what podcasts provide as a medium to, you know, what you're into.
I think that accessibility is really at the forefront now when you look at the modern day technology in vehicles where you can just Bluetooth your phone directly to your car. People are lazy. They don't want to get that cassette with the wire that goes to your phone or tune in through the radio. They want that simple Bluetooth technology. That's becoming more standard. So I think that has something to do with the podcast generation becoming more prevalent as well. I know we mentioned on Awesome Chat, and I can't remember the country offhand, but there is one country in Europe that is actually on the verge of disbanding FM.
It's one of the Netherlands.
Like, yeah, it's one of the Netherlands countries. They're actually on the verge of disbanding FM, and they're moving everything to an online radio and an online podcast format. So that's really the future. This country, I think we're going to take some time to get to that point because we're always on the back end of things like that, but that is definitely the way things are going.
And I think right now radio is still king, but with this is going to, that's why it's great everybody's into podcasting now, because it's important right now to start building your audience, because what's going to happen is the money's going to follow, and with that is all the market's going to flood. Because these companies, they're just going to buy podcasts, is what they're going to do if it turns that way, because they're million and multi-million dollar companies. So we're at a great position right now to start building our audience and building a foundation to be in a position to call your shots when those companies do start coming up, and they will.
I'm for sale.
There you go.
Cheaper than you might think.
So if you're out there, he's Professor Buzzkill.
Takes credit cards.
Yeah.
Yes.
I'll take your credit card. Yeah. Make off with it.
Well, and like I said, like Pittsburgh, and I always knew there were a lot of podcasts out there, but again, it felt lonely for a while. You know, and seeing the people coming out of the Podcamp and everything. Now I'm kind of figuring, do I have a place with everybody coming along to do a session of Podcamp? You know, with Lips and everybody representing. What do you think the scene is here in Pittsburgh? Next Pittsburgh just did an article about women in podcasting. Katie was mentioning that, of course. What do you think of the scene in general?
I think Pittsburgh's a little bit behind. Mm-hmm. I think if you were to go to California and just look at how many people listen to podcasts, there'd be probably 8 out of 10, 9 out of 10 people. But I think in Pittsburgh, it's more 2 out of 10, mm-hmm. somewhere around there. But I think that's slowly catching up. I think people, everyone around is starting to catch on to what we, all of us collectively are doing and putting out there. And it's a slow grind, but that's the podcast market has been a slow climb, and it's steady. It hasn't, it hasn't dipped, it hasn't dropped that much. It's steady climb, but it's slow. Well,
and I think it's also interesting now with Epicast, you're attached to a lot of comedy shows, you'll see an Epicast Presents. So I think there's a lot of you're getting that out there. ScareHouse is saying, hey, we have a podcast, or Jim's, obviously has his platform. Do you think is what's helping the growth of everybody saying, oh, podcast might be something that I can try?
Yeah, I definitely. So. Mm-hmm. You can bring content to what you're doing. You can make that personal connection to people. I think that's it. I grew up listening to Jim Krenn with my dad in the car for years. Mm-hmm. So I was, 6 years old, And, you get a personal connection, and that's why people dig it. That's why the morning shows do better than just the regular radio. And I think you get that with podcasts. People can make that connection and really know what's under the skin.
Yeah, I think you're right, but it is a personal connection with all your audiences, right? Mm-hmm. They know you. You're right. They get to feel the thing. That's the cool thing. That's the cool thing of a podcast. In mine, I started in 1988. It was like that, and corporations obviously, beat the artistic side of it out. But that's what's nice about the rebirth. It's like the rebirth of radio, yeah. Podcasting, right? It's like the rebirth of FM in a weird way, and mm-hmm. kind of we're on a ground floor, but in a way, because it's still not me. It's not as me. I just fell.
It's going to have one. Yeah.
Ground floor.
Not on the floor. But it's what's so cool. We're in the right place, I think, at the right time for this thing. It is exploding all over the country. I think I agree with Buzz. It's a little slower here. We were getting there, though. Mm-hmm. I worked at the first thing was a sideshow network, this company in L.A. that called me. So then Frank and I evolved. To get this radio guy, I couldn't fly out. They had to fly out there a lot to do their network every 6 weeks in L.A. But companies like Levity and all these big companies are investing in these podcast companies for a reason. They see it. They see the arc of what's going to be. And I think that what we're doing here, you're doing like these networks and that's what they're doing. And you're catching on here in Pittsburgh with it, but that is the way it's going to get to the next level, which is monetization, so we can make a living with these things.
And having a big enough footprint that you can catch advertisers' attention.
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. And Mike and I were talking about that too, the advertising. It's interesting. The whole concept is so unique with, we all come into the problem is, you have listeners, but the problem we're facing is, like radio stations with sales teams. And sales is just a different animal than what I can do. Some people are better at it than others. I'm not the worst sales guy ever. And the problem is, you have to kind of service the client. So, I'll get a client for maybe 3-4 months, but if you're not going to the games with them or lunch and this and that, just like the salespeople, they drop you because out of sight, out of mind, And so that's the thing, the hurdle we have to kind of jump and somehow figure out how we latch on to those clients that we don't have to service, that they're educated on us more or less. That's what I'm saying. We've got to kind of still educate them. Like Buzz, that's the slow part. Mm-hmm. The clients, in other words, advertisers have to come and get to the point where they're like, there's a lot of deep money to be made.
Yeah, and right now the money's all tied up in the top half of 1%. And people get paid tons of money for the podcast mm-hmm. if they're successful and you're over that magic number, but it's mm-hmm. like it's that magic number or nothing.
Yeah. And the magic number is so high.
It's millions of people, and it's not. So it shouldn't be. It should be. Everyone should have their niche.
At the same time, don't you think that we have an advantage in some ways where it costs, like for example, my entire radio network costs me, my operating costs, I think, are $200 a month. Mm-hmm. So I don't have a lot of money going out. Mm-hmm. So I can actually I could sell cheaper advertisement than say a radio station, which has to pay for the maintenance of the FM station and everything else,
that
and there's so many
the
big building on the parkway, all of these costs that are associated with it. Whereas maybe $10 from the local pharmacy down the street, to me, that's a huge additive to trying to curb my costs. Whereas a radio station, that's nothing.
Well, you're right. I was told Mike about this. A lady named Louise Hay is Hay House Radio. It's like self-help stuff, like Deepak Chopra and all, and it's brilliant what you're doing. and you get her app and all that, and it's free. But what she does is she has, like, Deepak Chopra will do a show from his beach house in San Diego from, on Monday from, like, 6 to 8 or something like that. And then after that, they'll throw it to this lady, you know, Noreen Virtue, whatever her name is. Like, you know, all these self-help people, this whole thing. She has what they're tapping in all over the country, and she figured out, that's exactly what you're saying. She doesn't have to have a building or mm-hmm. anything like that, and she could just tap in all the different people. Sure. And I think that what she did, that, I mean, that she's the one that I discovered, but I think that's the future. That is going to be what it's going to be, I believe, as far as we see radio. And the podcasts become the same programming as, you know, these radio shows. It's mm-hmm. basically a podcast put on the internet.
Yeah.
And that's, yeah, I do see that being huge. This lady's making millions upon millions mm-hmm. with this idea. But sure. that will be the future in the local markets, too, especially like what you're doing, like Pittsburgh or wherever, and sell ad dollars. And that's the way to do it, I think, through the ad time.
Yeah, because really, a small ad can go a long way for mm-hmm. a network that's...
The turnover rate's higher. The ads last forever. They're yeah. indefinite. And yeah. there's multiple advantages.
Exactly.
Because they have that connection that... You know,
and plus,
more likely.
We mm-hmm. also talked about that audience that we have, where we're so close to the audience, so connected to the mm-hmm. audience. Mm-hmm. So that audience is going to be impacted
That's
more
it.
By those advertising dollars than, say, a radio station where you have people tuning in and out. Maybe they hear it, maybe they don't. They zone out in between breaks.
Mm-hmm.
Here you're engaged, you're choosing to listen to. You've made a choice to listen. It's not being sent to you
mm-hmm.
versus yeah. on the radio. A lot of times, you know, you are flipping the channel. It's being sent to you.
Right.
Yeah, our listeners are subscribers.
Yes,
mm-hmm.
they're choosing.
Than,
they're going out of their way to listen
way.
To you.
Yeah.
Right. It's actually,
right.
way,
yeah.
in some ways, it's an inconvenience because they got to find you.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, for me, it took me a while to get into podcasting because I'm somebody, I like to be force-fed sometimes because I don't have the time necessarily to research and find the shows I like, and that's one of the advantages to radio. But on the flip side, if you are going out and you're taking the time to find that show and taking the time to listen to it every week, because it's not something that you just tune in on autopilot. It's something you have to make a conscious decision that I'm going to go listen to the Jim Krenn podcast, or I'm going to go listen to Drinking mm-hmm. Partners or Awesome Chat or ScareHouse or Professor Buzzkill.
Mm-hmm.
You've made that decision. It's not an autopilot thing.
Mm-hmm.
So.
And you're kind of attacking the programming, you're attacking the on-demand in a couple of different ways, which brings me to, now, for as long as I've been doing podcasting, I've been a fan of live.
Mm-hmm.
We always have a live chat room. Back in the day, I was on a Shoutcast server, as I was talking to Jim earlier, and we were in an AOL chat room, and three people were talking with us. Now mm-hmm. we're on YouTube Live and Facebook Live, and people are in a chat room there, and we're talking on Twitter and everything. For those of us that have delved in that, obviously with radio mm-hmm. and you know what you're doing, not everybody needs to do that, but what do you think live brings to a show versus this, you know, kind of polished NPR-y kind of thing? No offense.
Well,
no
just
offense,
can I
professor.
Yeah, no, yeah. Well, the reason I'm going to give the opposite argument, and that
sure.
is that my content is, in theory, evergreen.
Yeah,
except
yeah.
for when Sarah Palin said something about George Patton, and we jumped on it because we just had a show about Patton, and she very helpfully decided to weigh in on it. So that cost us a bit in ad revenue. So all of our stuff could be run at any time. Buzzy and I purposely decided to do it that way because I just couldn't devote the live time, if you will.
Yeah.
But people often say to me, you know, you need to have some sort of call-in segment, live segment, YouTube, something
yeah.
like that. And it seems so difficult. So.
And you've been playing with like live, like going places and doing an evening with Professor.
Well, Russell. Sure, yeah. But those are, again, recorded, and in theory they can be played anytime. It's not topical in terms of what's happening now.
Mm-hmm. Right.
I mean, I was just working on a show on Molly Pitcher from the Revolutionary War, and of course we can run that. The rest of time,
mm-hmm.
and we will run it for the rest of time because we need the money. But you know, it's a very difficult thing to do. It's just that everybody talks about it, so it seems really, really important.
You know, going back to the monetary thing, it's funny. I was at this thing with my wife, this banker last year, and this little old lady walks up to me, and she's talking about Glenn Beck. And I mean, listen, I'm like, and I go, yeah. She's like, I listen to him every day, and I'm like, I thought he was on Fox or whatever he was or something. I looked it up, man. He made $50 million last year.
Mm-hmm.
But the point I'm making is the live, like we were talking earlier, Mike, it's almost what you said. It's like, you know, it's yours is evergreen, but the live, there's something live wire by being live. And I think that gives you the opportunity to monetize it like a lot of those people are doing. They want to hear you fresh right there, that moment, and you can actually charge, you know, your audience something instead of selling the advertising, which, like I said, you service the clients. Well, the one way around it, I knew a radio guy, a buddy of mine, he got fired like 3 years ago, and he is, and I found out the other day, he said, oh, he's charging $4.99 or something like in a month. And I go, how many subscribers is it? He said, 2,600. I'm like, Jesus.
And it's just him.
Like, just him.
It's not an hour. It's
no.
Just what he does.
It's just him doing live every day. That's five a week, you know. But that's all he does is this thing for an hour, just like, you know, podcasts. And I said, huh. Now I'm thinking that with Beck and people, I think that's the future.
Who was that?
It was Jim Quinn. He has a podcast.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
And that's where he went.
Yeah.
That's what I thought.
But again,
and he's going out of his bathroom.
You don't know if Beck is going to do a thing. You don't know if he's going to do a thing. Yeah. They're doing just fine because they don't need that mass to know.
Yeah,
they just need those super fans to follow them and monetize.
Yes, the niche. And that's where we're saying that it's early. You know, it's been a while, but to get that niche, like you get the wrestling, and that's brilliant stuff, and you know, get your niche, and
that's
once
it.
You get 2,000, it sounds like a lot, but it's not, if you think about it, and if they can pay, you know, maybe it isn't $5, maybe it's $1 a month, so that's a lot of money. I mean, it's an amazing way to, and that's where it seems like it is going, it's
and
reality.
And there are a lot of tools about that. Patreon is one of them, it's kind of like Kickstarter, but you can kind of say, I'm going to give a buck for everything that releases. There's a guy, Tom Merritt, he was on the This Week in Tech Network. He got let go from that because he happened to move or whatever. So he just started doing the same kind of show and says, hey, give me a buck, give me a penny, whatever. I donate to his show because I've been listening to him for like three different networks. I've followed him throughout there. And now he's the poster child for this model because he's making like $15,000 a month on this podcast, you know? But again, it's all the tech luminaries are coming in and they're all his friends and everything over the years. And he brought his other shows over doing the same thing, and you can build that. You don't have to build an app necessarily. Like, the tools are really there. As long as you can activate an audience that thinks you're worth giving a penny to, giving whatever to, you know, then you can build that and kind of activate that a little bit. So
There are benefits to both live and doing it, like you said, a style where you can always go back and listen. I love live radio, and it's been killing me inside ever since I moved to pre-recorded. That's why I'm moving back to live radio. But I look at a show like on our network, Funny Money. I can put a Funny Money episode out anytime, and it's relevant. River Talk, once the next week rolls in, most of the stuff is not relevant anymore. I can't go and I can't market those shows. I can take bits out and market those again, but you know, it's very in the moment. So I think there's definitely an advantage as well to having some of these pre-recorded timeless shows that you can always pump out there. And I think it is true, you know, live, you can, I think there is something to it that draws people in, but I think that the time factor, the timeless factor of having a show that is evergreen, like you said, that there is something to that as well, especially from a network standpoint. I mean, that's something I, you know, if I'm low on material 1 week, I can drop a Funny Money episode and it works, but our sports program, you know, once the game's already happened, no one cares. So
the problem with evergreen content, I have to say, this is one of the benefits of live, is that you do have to research stuff and work it up. I mean, you can't just riff on what's going on. I mean, Buzzy's constantly angry with me because I'm like, I haven't finished my Molly Pitcher episode because I found another book. You know, and it just takes forever. And you can go, you really is a rabbit hole. So, you know, it definitely has its downsides. But I was going to ask Mike something about Patreon. I have Patreon, and I have a button. And apart from, you know, my parents, and with the Duke and Duchess of Buzzkill, and a couple of other people, I don't have many subscribers. But I push it to please, please, please. But I'm wondering whether the actual monetary subscription model is better. You know, for premium content or whatever, people are forced to buy, that they'll buy in more readily than just, oh, please, you know, support us.
If you know, like, you kind of have to feel that out. Like, is this enough? Like, are people into this enough that they will pay for that extra bit, right?
Yeah.
And I don't know.
Gold on Mayhem.
yeah, Gold on Mayhem, but the people that are subscribing, like, frankly, I think will subscribe anyways. Mm-hmm. And we give a little bit of extra content, but mm-hmm. you look at that list, it's long-time listeners, mm-hmm. And yeah. as is usually the case, long-time listeners usually become co-hosts with that show. Or then there's something like AwesomeCast, where, like, we had, like, two people that we don't interact with at all decided to give us $5 an episode, you know? So we just started deciding that, like, okay, you're an executive producer, we're going to send you a business cards, and we showed up at their door and gave them cookies at Christmas because they're a local. Mm-hmm. You know, like, stuff like that, like, to make them thank them, first mm-hmm. of all, because, like, wow, you think I'm worth spending yeah. a pretty significant amount of money on a podcast that I do mm-hmm. in my basement, right? You know, now those are the people you can say, listen, if we did this kind of thing over here, would you pay that for just that, you know? Mm-hmm. And if you have, and again, you have to figure out what that scale is. If you get 20 people dropping $5 a month, it's like, that's worth me doing that extra thing over here. And then can we grow that from there, you know? And you got to figure out what your way in is.
Do you think there's a certain download minimum you have to have before you start thinking about this? I have purely selfish motivations in asking this question.
We're like, this is
a bit more of a super fan number, which you couldn't measure.
Yeah. The people.
Well, that's true. Yeah.
The people that are like, man, Professor Buzzkill just said he needs a buck a month in order for me to keep listening to him. What percentage are going to come with you? What percentage of Howard Stern's people decided to drop the money for Sirius? Mm-hmm. The super fans.
You're right, my good. That's true. I'm at that dilemma, Frank and I. Little bit. In other words, when you name that price, you can't go back in a way. You know what I mean? With your fans.
Yeah,
so it's like,
yeah.
So what do you pick? So I have 100,000, what do you have, 100,000 subscribers, Ray Frank, something like that? So 100,000 subscribers. And then you have to sit there and think, now my first thought, I don't know, 99 cents a month you charge? Do you charge $2 a month? Are you under charge? That's the hardest decision I'm going to make, because how many of those people, what percentage are going to come with me?
And what's your break even for the content you're
What's going to come with me from the 100,000 people? 1,000, 100 people, 2,000, I don't know. And the other thing is, you want to make it so it's a number that they put on their card, just like we have with Netflix or whatever, whereas even if they don't go to it all the time, they're not going to really say, I'm not going to cancel 99 cents or whatever. You know, so it's got to be that, or dollar a night, whatever price you have. It's something that you don't, that's a tough thing. That's the economic
but
side.
But you're
it's
also competing with the Netflix, the Spotify's, you know, all that stuff.
Everybody,
and as it
yeah.
is.
Yeah. So it's got to be low enough. That, you
cord,
know.
Killer, cord cutters or not, like, I think there's definitely a thing that we're going to see very soon where people are getting fatigued of how many little things are coming out of my credit card every
sure.
month.
Mm-hmm.
But I haven't even listened to Spotify for a month, you know, things like that. Yeah. Now you're another thing that
another
comes
thing.
Out of that
yeah.
thing.
Yeah.
And, you know, or all these shows on Patreon, like, how many shows am I subscribing to again?
Yeah.
You know, and
yeah.
you know,
yeah.
and there's part of that audit to that as well.
Another mm-hmm. thing to consider.
On Patreon, and this is, I think, a challenge with podcasters. If you're on a network, you rarely, from a marketing point of view,
mm-hmm.
how do you capture those people? Because if you're on some of these networks, the emails belong to the network. They don't belong to you. Now, on Patreon, do the emails belong to you? Can you do an autoresponder and reach out to those people by email, or do you have to do it just within Patreon?
I think that you can get emails out of it. It kind of says, like, are you setting it up as the show, or is the network handling it for you? Is that kind of what you're talking about?
Yeah.
It activates it through the site, and I think there's a page in there where you can kick everybody's email out and, like, add to a newsletter or something
yeah.
as well. So, like, they're pretty good about that, I think. So, I haven't used it in that way, though.
But Patreon is a little bit, I mean, I maybe, you have 100,000 listeners?
Subscribers,
really? So close. Patreon isn't necessarily, for me anyway,
no.
isn't necessarily a huge moneymaker. You know, I could shake hands with everyone who's a Patreon patron in my group. So, I don't know, I'm pretty sure I'm able to harvest their emails.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that sounds terrible hard. but I haven't done it yet, and frankly, you know, thanks Aunt Ginger is the same thing as emailing for me, given who's on Patreon.
It's a big thing for my business. I own a full service marketing company. Mm-hmm. So the thing with us marketers is, how do you could have 500 people. I have high numbers for my shows when I do the shows I do. Now, how do you get those people out of some of those? You know, and it's a big issue. You know, call to action, get something for free. Sometimes collect their emails. That's what I'm working on right now. Give them something.
Yeah.
Giving away some tickets or whatever. But the big thing, Patreon would be very useful if you could set up, do Optimized Press or something, and set up an autoresponder. I'm sure you use Optimized Press. So do an autoresponder in there where you're constantly giving them, send out surveys. What do you want to hear this month? What do you want to do that? Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Well, and during Patreon, they're giving you money.
You have to have those emails.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Which, again, it activates through there, and I believe you can get the emails out. And as far as like a carrot for that, like say, you know, you can say, hey, we don't want to chase advertisers, right? We don't want to have to do the wine and dine and everything, mm-hmm. right? And we don't want to fill it with all the stuff that maybe you don't care about. And, you know, how many podcasts I listen to that I hear about 5 minutes Squarespace ad. I'm using it all the time. I'm good. Thank you. You know,
Dollar Shave
Club. But you can say, listen, if you don't want us to do any ads, kick in a couple bucks, and then we won't have to, you know. And we kind of do a balance, you know, with what we do, and kind of until one kind of supersedes the other, and we're like, okay, that's the direction. We're in a very much experimental filling out process as far as what we're using.
I think Patreon's at its make or break point. I think the next couple months you're gonna see a lot of big podcasts start Patreons. Mm-hmm. I'm hearing it already. People are starting about launches this summer, and I think it's like go time, and like, you know, there's going to be millions and millions and millions of more dollars flowing through that website soon.
Yeah.
Start Patreon.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Oh, and by the way, any of you thinking of starting a podcast, I personally would absolutely recommend doing a Kickstarter or a GoFundMe to start with, because, I mean, I literally knew nothing and was able to do it. We did a Kickstarter and I was able to buy my equipment and pay for the first several months of Buzzy's work and Libsyn and all that stuff. And I don't think we could have done it without those Kickstarter funds.
For sure.
Yeah. I think that's step one.
And you got to see, are people actually interested in this idea?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
You got to vary. It's not just, I want to sit with my friends and talk about pro wrestling, which is basically my concept. you know, no one's going to Kickstart that. But you're like, you have a background in this. You have a concept. You had an angle on it. And that activated people.
Mm-hmm.
Brian's been trying to talk.
Yeah, I wanted to talk. You mentioned subscription, and one of the things I wanted to put in people's minds: has anyone here ever run a volunteer organization, like a fundraising organization, like with Relay for Life or something like that? You have okay. Do you guys ask for a specific amount, or do you just ask for a general donation?
It depends entirely on what you're doing. Just recently had a ton of success by not asking for a specific amount, mm-hmm. even though I argued with that in my mind about, like, what if they throw a dollar in there and I want to choke them or something like that?
Yeah.
You know, but I've done both ways, and it, like I said, it depends entirely on what you're doing.
It's true.
How successful it is.
But if you tell somebody, I need $5, they're only going to give you $5. If you tell people, I need a donation, somebody may give $5. Somebody may give 30. You kind of open the door, mm-hmm. and you can, in a way, you can actually limit yourself by saying, you know, we're going to charge 99 cents. Everyone charges 99 cents. Well, you may miss that one donor who maybe is going to dump a money, you know, dump a big pile of money on you, because in their mind, once you set a parameter, now they're tunnel visioned on that parameter, and they're not thinking how they could enhance that that show and enhance the profits that they're sending you. Mm-hmm. So.
How
that's a good point.
That podcast has sponsorship.
They, I mean, like now, they go on and off. Like I said,
mine's
I'll have them 3 months, 4 months. Ray Frank will go. It's a service. It's a service. Them. And, you know, you're the first one cut from probably their ad agencies. Like, you know, the
you
car dealer
do
for
packages.
They won't go that long on podcasting. They're not, like Buzz was saying, the city's not educated. The advertisers aren't educated enough on podcasting to really.
I have 6 months sponsored.
Well, yeah, I mean, some are very popular podcasts.
6 months, a year.
You're my new saleswoman.
But you know what? In defense, I had a lot of trade people when I traded with them, and I put them up, and people started to notice.
Mm-hmm.
And I did networking. But one of the things that happened is CBS Local ran an article on the five best locally oriented podcasts produced here in Pittsburgh, and I was number two after Trip Sports Media. Positively, Pittsburgh Five was number two. Hard to be number one in a sports town, you know.
Yeah.
And I'm doing good news, you know, that's not, you know, it's doubtful. and it is, but it's not like if it bleeds, it leads. You know?
Mm-hmm. I wonder how those kind of, when was that?
That ran in November, maybe?
Okay. Yeah, I'm wondering if the trim scene, there's so many more of us doing this now and so much more creative and different unique things. I wonder if
they had the strip sports media, because I've been doing this 9 years, okay? And I'm prolific. I mean, I'm ubiquitous on the internet. I got blogs to match the podcast, mm-hmm. I've been doing it a long time. Before it was chic, I was doing podcasting. And so chic. So there was me, there's my girl got me started here. And there was me, there was Trib Media, there was that girl Mindy or somebody that goes all around, and then City, I think Pittsburgh Marta. City Paper. She goes around the city, I forget her name.
Marta.
What is it?
Marta on the Move.
Marta on the Move. Yeah. And then City Paper. Mm-hmm. And I don't know who the fifth one was, but there are five of them. Mm-hmm. And then then CBS Pulse did an article on how I used podcasting to resurrect my business after I lost my limousine business in 2004. So that just, like, people just started coming to me as, like, how come you even ask me? And people were coming to me and saying, how come you ever asked me to sponsor your podcast? And I'm like, oh, yeah, okay, all right. I had all this stuff ready. I just never pushed the button.
Yeah. Well, it was nice because you got mainstream media kind of acknowledge you, and you got a nice kind of, like, hey, this is a real thing.
Yeah, I think that's finally coming.
Mike, it's a long time coming.
Oh,
In 2009, I won the National Small Business Administration Journalist of the Year Award, mm-hmm. nationally. And I put up that, and I got 39 hits. I put my picture with George Takei from Star Trek, and I got 473. So, you know, it's a long time coming. I've been doing this when people thought I did a presentation for Nando, and they thought it was swear word. They thought, you know, they thought a podcast was a swear word. And so we coined the term TalkCast, okay, because we ran like a radio show, mm-hmm. Several of us. And then what happened was we had a podcast 2 years ago, all of a sudden podcasts out there, yep, what? Hashtag podcast. I'm sorry, I'm vague with my call. It's called Pound Podcast. I'm like, you know what I'm talking about. When your mother tells you to go buy pound of meat. Anyway, so I'm putting the hashtag podcast in here, and my numbers doubled overnight. Because all of a sudden people know what a podcast is. Not everybody still does, but all of a sudden people know what a podcast is. So I just want to say, all of you sitting up there, you're thinking too small. Put a number in your head. You got a niche market. There are people that want to reach your niche market. They will pay you.
I think you're right, and that's something that I've thought about too.
Seriously, can we hire her?
Yeah. Yeah, but I do like
thinking like that.
I would tell you to get rid of
her. And I think she's right, and that's why.
I produce podcasts for people, and I market their podcasts.
No, and I think she's absolutely right, and that's one of the directions that we're looking to go with our network. We're only a little over a year old, so we were kind of solidifying our brand, and now we're looking to ask local businesses in the community, and I think that they would be foolish not to go with us.
Absolutely.
And that's kind of the direction that we're thinking, and we're not going to target necessarily the larger companies. We're going to start with the local bakery, the local diner, and then as we grow, we can expand, but
I'd rather
money is money.
Yeah, I'd rather keep it with the local companies anyway.
Sure.
It makes way more sense, you know.
No. Local is good. We've got money here in Pittsburgh. People are willing to spend it.
Yeah.
And you can shake loose of their money. You can. It's all a matter of saying, I've got this. This is evergreen. You go do, and I sold an advertisement for being a marketing company. You have here, you buy 30 second spots. What happens? They go away. Or like you said, they're not applicable anymore. Right. But a podcast, if they do their ad right, and I always help them write their ad, they do their ad right, it's evergreen. Mm-hmm. And here's the thing, even though my shows are live, okay, and I don't edit, and I'm probably not the best podcaster in the world, but I got great listeners and they're dedicated. Mm-hmm. Okay? Mm-hmm. And when I won that award, I was using a Cricket phone to do my podcast for the first 3 years. I used a Cricket phone for 3 years.
And you're on TalkShoe.
I'm on TalkShoe.
Which, by the way, good news
just
for TalkShoe recently.
Yeah. Just got bought. Just got bought. I got my eye on it.
The CEO tweeted me and says, you want in the beta? I'm like, yes, I do. I'm going to
sit back. And I wrote back to him. I told him all the things that we needed, again, yes. That I thought we needed, like branded page, et cetera, et cetera. He wrote back to me and asked me if I would like to, because he looked at how long I've been in there. My number is 18520. Mm-hmm. I've been in there a long time, mm-hmm. since Dave Delson was there. And I made an appointment with me to sit down and tell him what we need. So anybody, whatever you need, tell me, because I'm sitting down talking to the guy.
Local company as well. Mm-hmm. Wexford. Well, I don't know about the company at the bottom, but
I didn't know that.
They're from up in Wexford. They actually sponsored that at the first Podcamp Pittsburgh. We're over at the Lakers for the first one. So,
you're in a unique position. I tell people about you, and they think, I mean, I'm a Periscope junkie, thanks to you. I had somebody tell me the other day that I need a Periscope intervention. Because I'll Periscope, I just Periscope this, my phone died. I need an iPhone.
You're like acknowledged Snapchatting over here earlier. He was taking the storm and everything. He was like, hey, I snap everything. I'm snapping this. I'm snapping this coffee.
I was wondering, how do you hold on to your, like, friend sponsors, for instance?
My sponsors?
Yeah.
I'm a little unique in what I do because I have Positively Pittsburgh Live magazine, which, by the way, is Pittsburgh's first. I advertise as Pittsburgh's first internet radio and TV network. It's 7 years old. Now I call it Pittsburgh's premier podcasting portal. Mm-hmm. It's free for people to use, but you can buy a channel on there very inexpensively, and it's your channel, and it's great for local SEO. You get about 3 million hits a year, and we're doing a campaign to bump that up to about 10 million this year. And for a little site, 3 million is not bad,
Huge.
So what I do is that all my shows, because I needed content when I started this, I created a bunch of shows so I have content. Because now, after about 3 years, I turn it into an online turning page magazine. So every week, all that goes into online turning page magazine and also a PDF, complete with live links to the video podcast and the audio podcast. And so people can just go hear the turning page, go in there and listen. It's very popular. It's one of my popular sites, and my site just mom the flagship on Positively Pittsburgh, like that and the Technogranny show. So I'm a little more unique because I have a lot of cross marketing. Mm-hmm. Every time I podcast, I do a blog. Mm-hmm. From the blog, I do something else. I throw it up on Pinterest. I'm everywhere. Mm-hmm.
I think that's a good thing to point out. Now you have a whole system you figured out over years, but it's not just podcasting. When we're talking about the sponsors and everything like that, there was a really good presentation by the She Podcast and Kelsey Escobar that I know works with has worked with Lips, and at least in the past. I think she still does her podcast. It's not just the numbers of your podcast; it's also the rest of your social media. We have Slice. We get a pepperoni pizza every week, so we have something to feed our guests when they come in every Tuesday, right? Across all their shows. And we're thanking them on Twitter, and people are talking about that and everything. We're having fun with
you. You're everywhere too. And here's what I would suggest to you, because you're everywhere. Let me just give you real quick. Mm-hmm. Okay. When someone is a sponsor on my show, okay, first of all, I'm on player.fm, I'm on Stitcher Radio, I'm on iTunes, and I'm on 40 other directories. So now, right away, there's your 45 places. Their name's going to go in my description because I have 16 segments sponsored by whoever. Okay. Now, they know just 45 places right there. Then they're going to go in my Facebook page. Then they're going to go on my Twitter feed. And, I got about five, I don't know, about 10, one of them has 10,000, I got about 65,000 people in my social media with everything that I have. And then they're going to go on Pinterest. So I give them a list of all the, and Mike, you should do the same thing. I give them a list of all the places they're going to be. How can you not give me $300 a month to sponsor this segment?
Right.
Mm-hmm. Are you crazy? And I have 16 segments. I get them all sponsored. I'm retired.
That's probably, that's a smart thing. Well, mine, it'll say, like, we do ours for, like, if you get a car dealer, give us $4,000 a month and stuff. It lasts for a few months and stuff. It's 100,000 subscribers. But like I said, we're competing against radio. Now, radio may charge them 15 or 20 million. But like you said, as we were saying, how to educate people. Now, they have to translate into sales. If you don't get sales, enough sales, they're not coming in talking about it. Yeah. That's when it takes time, as you know, for any kind of, it takes more than 2-3 months.
Yeah.
You have to get kind of lucky, maybe, and somehow get sales. But that's where the trouble is, where they want instant, because they don't know what it is going in, most people, and that, because they're going against, you're competing against the radio. Yeah. So they're like, I know what that is. I know what you did on radio, Jim. Well,
My
cousin Chucky never mentioned the podcast. Did he hear it? No. Well, no, maybe he didn't. That's the problem. Cousin Chucky has to hear it, know it, and reaffirm to this owner that this is here in his car dealer. And after 3 months or four, that's the trouble right now, anyway.
You have to educate them to how much they're getting.
Yeah.
They're getting about 100 times more than what they're getting with radio.
You do. It's a hard battle to educate
them. Well, the other thing is radio's going on and saying, we're in X amount of households. Like, I'm not turning the radio on. I don't turn it on when I get in a car and listen to a podcast. So they don't have, they don't know how many people are actually listening other than arbitrary numbers or whatever,
yeah,
and there's a question out there. Versus,
we
know it's X numbers.
Downloads,
we don't know how long or anything
dollars.
Like that. But, and I think that's the other thing is there's the comparison, and like I said, the education. They're saying X amount of homes versus we're saying 1,000 people listen to this. You can say, yeah, we're basically accessible worldwide. Like, you can start saying that in comparison, mm-hmm. but here's something in the back.
Yeah, no, I want
and
to
you,
tell you, Jim, you know what I started to do? I started to do remote broadcasts and slash the price. For a radio, it's $1,500, $2,000 to do a remote. Pay me my talent fee and I'll come do a live broadcast. So that's what I started doing. And people pay me to do it. And the day I did a Metro PCS broadcast for 2 hours, just strictly all radio.
Yeah.
So you pay me my talent fee, I'll put my computer and my mic and I'll do a live broadcast. And on Mixler, it tells you how many people are listening and you tweet out the links and then it tells you, but we doubled their sales in 2 hours, for 2 hours I was there.
Mm-hmm.
It's all on the internet. Same thing radio does, but
yeah.
I just pay me a little bit more than my talent fee and I'll come out. I got a table skirt and I got all kinds of logo stuff, just like a radio station.
Right,
does,
right.
Except I do it independently.
Here's a guy to
same
watch
bit.
Too.
Yeah. That's
Al Levine, the talking machine. I'll let you know who he is. He does Pittsburgh Sports Talk.
Mm-hmm.
And he's somebody who used to work for me at the Hackathon Pittsburgh, and he just started doing this. And he's on YouTube. He charges people to come, like he does, to their place. Okay, and do a live show, because what happens, people want to get on his show, because they know it's going to be on YouTube. He gets incredible downloads, and they pay him. He started out charging $200, up to $500 a night, just to come in there and do a live show.
Wow.
And then people are coming in there, then he brings the crowd with him. So, you know, it's there's things you can do.
Yeah, especially if you have, like, a lot of the comedians we work with, you know, have a following. There's no reason you can't
for
make
you,
a brand in a show.
I don't know what you do. Yeah. This is the first, I sort of heard about you, but I really did not. I'm really interested in what you do. And I think for you, it's like falling off the log. You can go in there and do those live shows.
Oh, we do. We
and
do
bring
all
people
right.
people with you.
Do
you
do
get
all
paid?
Time. Yeah.
There
oh, yeah.
you go, see? So yeah. you are getting paid. You are making money.
The city's growing younger. A lot younger. People are moving in, and I think a lot, if you look at the right businesses, they're looking to attract those younger people, and those younger people are going to want something like a podcast. So I think you're right where those business opportunities are out there. You look at where I live in Millville, for example, we have two breweries, we have a dozen bars, and they're all fighting to get those younger people across the bridge from Lawrenceville into their bars. And that's one way that they can advertise, you know, hey, we have this new cutting-edge station, this new cutting-edge podcast network coming in, doing shows, doing things here in our bars. And I can tell you they are open to it. We're looking to move some of our shows on location.
And millennials want podcasts. That's
they
the
do.
Thing. They
yeah.
don't like TV. They don't like radio. Here's the thing about podcasters. You want to know some numbers? Number one, people listen to podcasts are not like us in this room here, okay? They are people that have three or more, and I've done the demographics, they have three or more mobile devices, that's number one. They are usually college educated, that's number two. Number three, they have 1.5 kids. They have an income of over $150,000. I've done all the numbers, okay? They have disposable income to spend on things that your sponsors are selling, and that's what you need to sell it to.
And I know we're talking a lot about kind of like there's a lot of content providers, we're chasing advertisers, finding ways to monetize something like that, where like the podcast is the product, right?
Mm-hmm.
Professor Buzzkill is the product, and he's trying to get somebody to fund that through advertiser, Patreon, whatever the case may be. But there's also another angle of, like, Katie represents ScareHouse.
Mm-hmm.
You're not necessarily chasing advertisers or anything, you're promoting ScareHouse. We have clients in it, and Buzzy, I think you have a few podcasts like that too, or for clients where it's an informational piece, and that's not, you know, if we're
it's
talking
brand
about
building.
It's
like a
yes, brand building. ScareHouse, we were just talking about this yesterday. Like, tell us, cover a little bit about what your target is for your podcast and your audience.
Within the last 6 months or so, it's been a target of either more consistency, reaching a larger audience, because we were specifically just on iTunes, and because it was as far as like our marketing and media, it was like podcasting was way down here. We were doing it, but we weren't doing anything to support it. But now, like, what we're doing is we're trying to reach out to the community and things in the community. We were recently with Replay FX. Because they're doing an event at the Heinz History Center, so we went out to their, they have a warehouse full of over 800 pinball and video games, which I absolutely geeked out over. But now they're going to work they have a thing in the convention center in July, and we're going to have a table there. So we're just kind of helping each other move things along. We worked with River's Edge this past weekend for May Days. We brought zombies, and now, you know, River's Edge talked about ScareHouse, and we talked about River's Edge. So yes. Everybody kind of works together, and it's a nice symbiotic relationship.
Hmm. But you have, like, you know, you already
have
an audience.
Paid for that?
I get paid for, this is my job, not like paid.
It's your job.
Yeah, not, like, I don't get
paid
nine to
for.
Five. Yeah.
But she's like
the, 9 to 5 thing.
Yeah, she's like the marketing person for them,
mm-hmm.
so
for
that
sure.
is her job, mm-hmm. is to put that content and activate.
All over the place.
Mm-hmm. And that's partly her. and her traveling zombie
very
show.
Very cool. I never
but,
understood. I didn't have a chance to listen to it, but I watched those things. Mm-hmm. I see you everywhere.
Oh, thank you.
but you know, you're informing the audience, keeping them in
mm-hmm.
so they can buy a ticket later.
Mm-hmm.
For me, I'm working with some groups that are, they don't actually, aren't trying to sell anything. All they're trying to do is inform a group. There's a competition, a collegiate competition, and they sell out in 15 minutes. They don't need more people to buy tickets. They need to talk to them about the competition and the technical aspects. So when they show up to a field in the middle of Tennessee, they know that their car is ready to go and they can actually participate in the thing that they've been working on for the last
mm-hmm.
9 months, right? And you, tell us a little bit about you, what you do with clients.
It depends on the podcast,
mm-hmm.
really. So like we, you know, it's really different for everyone. Someone else got. Well, I'm right.
But what I'm saying is, it's more than just, because I know there was a couple people that they had some business that I was talking to before here. You know, so it's not just I need to go out and be a personality and be an advertiser, you know, and play that game, because that is like content creation and chasing advertising is
mm-hmm.
the hardest, like one of the hardest mm-hmm. things. I think it's competitive with restaurant business or something.
Oh,
to kind of break
yeah.
that out there,
yeah.
it's tough. You got to wine and dine. You got to do all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
And you are the product versus talking about you know, much of social media, making you the expert. So they'll come to you if you're a chiropractor or a psychiatrist, like some of the clients that I've worked with in the past, or a counselor or something like that. You know, it's that get to know you part. So you'll
yeah.
come in the door, right? It's the more they're familiar.
They pick up and see what you're doing,
exactly.
and they kind of, I like that. You know, that's what we go for with all the visual content we provide
mm-hmm.
within the network. You know, me and Nick both take photos, and all our friends take photos. So that really helps. You know, set an impression of quality of work.
Yeah, yeah. Well, especially small businesses. You know, there's. I used this example last night. Of you could go to McDonald's anywhere in the country/the world because you know what you're expecting when you're coming through the door. There's a barrier of entry there. Versus, you know, I'm Shelly's next door, right? Not to say that the podcast is the right aspect, but you, like, I'm like, it's a local place, I don't know. You walk in and find it's cash only. You know, when you go to a local place, like, is it gonna be one of those weird cash only places? I hate doing that. You know, what's gonna be like? You're gonna skip that and go to that thing you're familiar with. You're gonna go to Arby's down the street, right? And the more that you have that opportunity for somebody to listen and say, you know, if somebody's gonna work on my back, you know, the doctor has to sell themselves
mm-hmm.
at that point as an expert and someone that you can talk to that will actually listen to you. So it's not just going on and I can't do one of these without spilling something. I have a lid. But I just want to make clear, it's not just going out talking about things and you know, chasing sponsors and everything like that. But there's a lot of different ways that you can use podcasting as an informational tool as well, you know. And it's okay. And also, it's okay. Advertising, we're talking about like the clips and says, yeah, we're not going to talk to you unless you have 5,000 per episode in the first week, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's like, okay. Versus clients are like, yeah, we had 100 people download this thing. And they're talking about it, and you know, or we had 40 people watch this video, and we got 2 clients, and that paid for the video.
Mm-hmm.
It depends on what you're selling, right?
Mm-hmm.
So you guys are doing these podcamps, but what's the next? Now that Pittsburgh has this nexus of podcasting, what's the next big event that people are going to find out about this, and you're going to attract advertisers, you're going to attract fans, you're going to attract people that want to be into the technology. So what's beyond Podcamp, I guess, the question? What do you guys see happening next?
You talking about as far as platforms or
a bigger event to attract more people to do what we're doing right now?
Well,
what would you like to have?
I'm not sure you want to do that.
Someone told me there's supposed to be a Podcamp or a Pittsburgh Podcast Festival this year. So
I've heard that too. Speculation.
Well, that's a good. I'm sorry. Yeah. Good
Pittsburgh Podcast Festival. Mm-hmm.
Some of us.
Well, you know what? Like even like Buzz saying, and that's a good question actually. I'm gonna get back to the whole thing. I start with the monetary thing. I'm like Gordon Gekko up here, somewhere.
But that's the crux of it. We all want to do that.
That's the goal.
How can I make money at this?
Yeah.
I'm like,
and that's where
really,
yeah, that's where we all really want to brainstorm and share ideas.
Yeah.
But the thing is, I do want to, you know, as we all know, I don't have to say his name, but you guys, the main thing is not the money, but the love and doing a performance and a podcast.
Mm-hmm.
The money will follow eventually, whatever, if it doesn't, whatever. But that's the main
passion.
The
value. Passion.
The value of what you do, and you love to do it. Like, I like doing comedy. You love talking about wrestling. You know, the comedy and the angles and your personality and
history.
No, you're a funny guy. Humor, political. But point of making is, it'll organically happen.
Yeah,
so this happened now, but what will happen is, you know, new podcast. Like, eventually, yeah, we will have a Pittsburgh podcast convention. I believe as this passion grows because of what we started the very first thing with the technology,
mm-hmm.
With it getting so, you know, easy and commonplace, you're going to see the next generation of podcast. You're going to see more and more, in other words, and some will break out, maybe be national, whatever, and then we'll start seeing that organically. But it will happen. Yeah,
and I think that's what Kate was saying about, you know, a podcast being one string to your bow. You know, there might be a book in it down the line. There might be all kinds of other things. There might be a film in it down the line. You never know. Right. Well,
Think about this an e-book, and I have one. I have an e-book, okay? And it has links to all my podcasts in it. That's how I did it through one of my podcasts. And then I blogged it, and then two weekends, I put the book together, threw it up on Amazon, and my 3 days, it was number 2 for business books and number 2 for marketing for those 3 days for free books because I had a network. So you guys can consider your network, consider all kinds of cross-marketing, and it will come to you. Yes, if you love what you do, but let me tell you something. There's a mission, there's message, and there's mission, okay? The message is wonderful, that's where the love comes in. But the mission is probably to make money, because guess what? It's fun making money. It's not fun doing it and not making money. I don't care what you're saying here. I'm an old hippie, okay?
I gotta say, when monetization came up at PodCamp 1, I was dismayed by it. I was in the hippie mentality of a podcast. I'm like, I'm about to community, man. What do you mean we can make money at this? And now, it's my business.
No, we want to make this a business, but the core of it. Mark Maron did not sit there thinking of marketing or any bullshit. He went in his garage. He was fed up with what it was going on with him on the road, and he just pulled up and did his thing. And people gravitated toward it, and they just mushroomed. Then the money came. That's what I'm trying to say. Don't forget that. That's where it's all going to happen.
I should
be the report. Remember, I remember when I got on talk to you, being a report one, that's when they used to pay you for downloads.
Yeah.
And you had to get 1,000, right? And Leo LaPorte was there, he had like 100,000 downloads. I was like, oh man, I just had this many. I got to 1,000. I was so happy that I had 1,000 downloads. It's not paying. I was super pissed off.
Oh,
okay.
We were buying pay-per-views with that money. That was great. that was like, it's fun to get a show, sure. My man.
This came up recently that there was a Washington Post article about podcasting, and it was talked about last week on This Week in Tech about the future of podcasting and how the bigger name producers like Apple isn't paying attention and so on and so forth.
This is actually in my notes I haven't gotten to yet.
I thought we'd have the same wavelength on this. I want to know, because we're talking a lot about monetization and sponsorship and so on and so forth, are we afraid that eventually it's going to be regulated like radio? Like, for instance, I don't want somebody to tell me that I can't drink on my podcast, because I drink on my podcast every week. To tell the drinking partners that they can't have beer, what are they going to be? Just the partners. And are we afraid that that is what the future is going
just
to become? Just
the partners.
Like, for real. Like, that's what the future
might
be.
You could list
to Amanda every Wednesday at 10 a.m. at River, 7 a.m. at River.
Just to clarify, because I heard the same conversation.
Right.
And they were saying, because of the for context, the article was saying, because if you're, everybody knows, like, you can't get to talk to somebody at Apple to fix your podcast feed or whatever the case may be. It's pretty much a Wild West, and they don't really pay attention because they're too busy selling apps and Deadpool right now. and the conversation they're saying is like, but do we really want that? Because do we want an approval process with Apple just like their apps? Because how many times have you heard about apps being pulled because they didn't agree with something or whatever the case, or content, right? And I'm like, well, I'm out. I got a parental advisor at the beginning of my thing. Drinking partners are probably out too, right? That kind of thing.
Or even just the simple swear words. We've all sworn on our podcast. If that starts to regulate, is that the fear that eventually that will happen, or is it just going to renegade so much that the provider is not like an FCC
or anything?
Well, one of the problems right now, people are putting like licensed music on their podcast and getting away with it. If you sneak, you can sneak past, not put it on your first episode. There's a human listening to your first episode from iTunes. If they catch a swear word, they're going to send it back. We've done it. We gave a clean rating and had a swear word, and they caught it and sent it right back. But I think that, there's going to be a lawsuit or, a big thing happen down the road from people doing that, and that's going to open up the floodgates for those kind of,
I'm more worried about the government, to be honest. I mean, they've already tried to make internet a public utility, and they're trying to weasel their fingers into it as...
Let me tell you, I'm a Twitter cop, and I did something really stupid. I did a Periscope, something silly. I wanted to do something silly, though. This conference, this guy wrote, what was that thing they wrote? How many of you freaks want to watch this?
Yeah.
And they got 290 watchers, viewers, in 5 minutes, okay? So I was with somebody, and another businesswoman, who owns a big business, she's from Nava, and she did this little thing talking about, this is what I do, but we're talking glaze, and she said she was doing this thing, we must increase our bust. Okay, now, be right to put it there, pound, increase your bust size. 73 people watched, they were all men. Okay, that's number one. The next thing that happened is I started to get all these people following me on my podcast Pittsburgh feed, and I opened up one because he said he wanted to have more friends in Pittsburgh, and I don't know why I opened it up, but I wanted to see what he did so I could see if I wanted him really having my Twitter feed, and it was a dick picture. Honestly, though.
That's a stone, naked. It's not.
Now, they can't clean that up.
It's not about regulating the internet. What's happening is that they're going to go into these places like Pittsburgh Podcast Network, and they're going to go into Libsyn, and they're going to go into Epicast, and all these producers, and they're going to go, guess what? You can't produce these shows anymore because you're going to be paying fines.
And if you do, you're up for a federal lawsuit.
Right. Are we fearful that that's what's going to happen?
A little bit, and I think I'm a little bit. I don't think it will come to that, but I think one of the opportunities for that to happen is people, illegally putting out music and that's going to cause government concern, right?
If you have that 7 second royalty thing, then what happens?
People
just follow copyright.
You run
it
12
laws.
Seconds and boom, you're in trouble.
I think the government will follow the lobbyists and the businesses. And this is reading an article about 6 months ago. Yeah. Madison Avenue still hasn't quite known how to handle a podcast. No one's reflected what we're saying tonight, but the monetization. Madison Avenue really doesn't know what to do it yet. They will, I think, when it gets in cars, like we were saying earlier, and different things like that. And I think when it does get to that, with Madison Avenue, in other words, where it gets mainstream, and a lot of podcasts are making millions, like the Marins who exploded, he led, they followed, but it's going to be other ways of monetizing. When I'm saying that, the big advertisers come. When that happens, now you got lobbyists going to the government and saying, we want some restrictions, we want some control over these people, over networks.
That might happen.
Well, to a degree, I think, just like they did with radio. Radio, when I first started, one person was allowed to own a radio station, one.
Right.
And within 10 years, two, and then 15 years. Lobbyists paid to two corporations can own five each, which is the whole market of any top 30 markets, the top 10 stations, and other people that really have big monetization. So if you get fired, you only have one other company you can go to. And then, they start cutting all these young people in voice tracking, and which killed creativity to see the next person. In other words, it got to the point where hundreds and hundreds of millions of dollars they can buy lobbyists. Yeah, maybe years from now. I think we're ways away, and I think we'll make our money. We'll be part of it. No, I'm kidding.
We'll be the lobbyists up there trying to control things.
There's another generation. We'll be the one buying them off.
Switch careers.
Yes, cigars.
station in trouble, all of a sudden you're going to be the show that the other stations don't want.
Mm-hmm.
And
sure.
That's what it's going to snowball into is you're then blacklisted.
It could be a thing where they say that if it's on iTunes, then no, you're not allowed to have those. You know, swear words, but then someone might have iTunes 2.0 and that kills it. Look at Sirius Radio.
Exactly.
We've been talking podcasting, netcasting, talkcasting, whatever, but the whole point of this is it's all based on a very open technology.
Mm-hmm.
We don't have to deal with iTunes. We don't have to deal with Libsyn. I can just put it on a server in my house, put it out there and say, hey, everybody, hit this button and this works here,
mm-hmm.
and there's an app over here that reads the RSS feed.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a bundle of technology that makes podcasting work that isn't really regulatable.
Well, yeah, like you said, we're still the Wild West, and the good thing is, by the time that happens 30, 40 years from now, new technology will come out.
We'll be on Mind VR cast in the back, and then I'll get you.
I have a question. It was kind of what Ryan was talking about, the next big event. I was talking to Buzzy about this, because I just recently went to LA, because my background's radio, if you don't know me, but I went to a big radio summit, and they had about 7 panels on podcasting, and I was talking to premier networks, and these are syndicators of radio shows, okay? And what they were saying to me is, first off, they're going to force all the personalities to have podcasts, so right?
Mm-hmm.
And now they're trying to, how are they going to monetize from the radio business, because they have a bigger platform, right? Mm-hmm. So my question to you is, A, are you going to go to this big podcast thing they're doing in Chicago? Because everyone in LA was talking about that, and these big people are going.
Is that progress movement?
Yeah, I don't know what it is, but he said you have to be there.
Mm-hmm.
So, well, my question is, since when you have these millennials, and podcasting is, and I think it's great that it should be focused local, because I do think that, but podcasting is on-demand audio, meaning people in LA can choose something on the East Coast, vice versa. How do you compete with such a large medium when you have now radio is like, I mean, they're jamming it down the throats. I mean, I have people coming up to me, I mean, I want to sell my segments back to the radio. That's what I'm trying to do, right?
Mm-hmm.
So they have these people that are digital content makers for huge companies that are asking for digital content now, which is like somewhere where radio hasn't really been going. So now you have all this national competition. So
it's content,
how do you compete with that?
Content and quality.
That's it.
But if it's not up there, it's going to fall to the bottom. That's how it's been on iTunes, and you see that. You know, shows will come and peak and hit new and noteworthy and do okay. Then, as soon as that happens, they fall right down. And you know, they had high ranking numbers and were the shit for you know.
But you guys
10 days.
Have done a good job with, like, you guys have listeners in other places.
Yeah,
like
we have
saying,
a bunch
like
of shows that are we have some shows
places.
That are a Pittsburgh market
yeah.
that talk about Pittsburgh that do better in LA than they do in Pittsburgh.
Like, how do you accomplish that?
I just think that it's a it's the. First of all, comedians, you know, LA is the comedy scene for sure. And I think more people listen to podcasts there. So, you know, in reality, I'm getting, you know, the same ratio of listeners, you know, but it's per, you know, selection, the same pound for pound, the same amount. But
I also think organizations like these have a chance to succeed against companies like you're talking about because there is more freedom here. I actually have somebody who has a background in radio. He's been on both CBS and some other networks in the local area who's looking to come to our network because we offer him freedom to talk about what he wants to talk about.
Right,
versus
what I'm saying is what their focus was is now they're going to force radio personalities to have podcasts.
But they're still going to be managing top down. The radio company is still going to tell them what they need.
Not necessarily.
To a point.
From what the panels that I heard in LA, they were like, it's a freedom that your personalities can't have on the radio. So what you need to do is let them have freedom to drive them back to the radio.
But don't you think that those companies are going to tie that back in and try to be restrictive? Because
they're trying to figure out how to monetize it. That's what,
yeah.
When I was talking to Premier Networks, which again syndicates radio shows,
yeah.
They're like, we are trying to figure out how to monetize this.
There's no thing that we're talking about.
I just can't. I just have a hard time, I guess, grasping Premier Networks.
I don't know that. I understand what you're asking. I don't know how to answer that. I'm just telling you that.
Oh, I know what you're saying. Yeah.
On the edge of trying to figure that out and being on the forefront of, because they know that's.
I just can't see someone like Premier Networks putting a podcast out there without wanting to have their fingers in it to say you're going to push our brand our way. Even though they maybe try to make it more free, but you know what I'm saying? Because
no,
you get these larger companies.
I'm just telling you that they're discussing that. That's
what
I'm saying. Like,
no,
I don't know if that will work. I don't know what will happen with that, but they are, radio it understands where
mm-hmm.
it's going, and
mm-hmm.
they are trying to monetize it, and they are trying to force the little bit of personalities they have left to
yeah.
do it, is what I'm saying.
Oh, no, I definitely see that push.
I think the biggest thing, because we were having this conversation earlier, too, like if you have a name like I Can't Compete With Smith, Kevin Smith, I Can't Compete With the Stone Cold Steve Austin podcast, because there's a name. But hey, there's a Stone Cold Steve Austin fan, there's a Kevin Smith fan that just found out what a podcast was. You know, there's a bunch of radio
right, yeah.
people that they're going to say, the word podcast is going to pop up on radio more, right? Or I'm on the iHeartRadio app. When Mikey and Big Bob are saying, hey, we're on iHeartRadio, and I think they have some wrestling fans in their audience, they're going to look up wrestling and wonder if this is on here, and they're going to find my show right next to them. It's an opportunity. You're not going to, I mean, and also, we don't need to get the numbers that they need to make that worthwhile. They need to know they need to go there, but they're still trying to figure it out. And much like the kind of nimble money issue that we talked about earlier on this panel. So, again, kind of managing the expectations. I'm not going to go head to head with Stone Cold Steve Austin.
So you're saying you don't even compete with them?
No, you're not. You don't need that. You have a niche that you can activate.
I was just saying, like, more so on a general basis, that when you're doing podcasting, anybody from anywhere can listen to anything, is
right.
what I'm saying.
But sound quality is so important to me. I think
yeah.
like sound quality is huge. I see a lot of people, you know, like I got a podcast today that's due out tomorrow from two popular comedians that was recorded on an iPhone, and I'm not going to listen to it myself. I'm going to get through it as quick as possible because I don't want that in my ears. You know, I want, like, that's, radios always sound great. You know, they, you know, granted it's degraded over the FM signal, but
you can get good quality for a lot cheaper than the radio.
Oh yeah.
Well, it is, but I agree with Buzzy. We were just talking about this earlier. There was someone that they were doing something and they didn't have any mics, and I'm like, maybe I come from radio background, so I'm like, you have to have mics. Like, you can do whatever, like you said, you can do it on iPhone, you can do it on these things, but you really, it does have to be quality audio, I believe. That's
right.
just, I
right.
believe.
And you're talking, this is the guy that started on like two $15 PC mics from Radio Shack, and we built and up from there. Now, I think there's less excuse to start with that, you know, because everybody's got an iPhone, like, oh, spend $50 on a mic, you know.
Well, that's why Work Hard Pittsburgh's really great. I'm not trying to, you know, put a plug over.
Yeah, places like this.
It's awesome because you pay, and then I have access to everything that I need, and I can use it.
And
so
you're seeing
like,
this grow. I mean, you're seeing this grow.
Yeah.
We're looking at some opportunities for my business. There's a place called Studio Me that's supposed to be opening in East Liberty, so you can go and talk to experts, and there's people like us there saying, hey, you need help with a podcast, right? Or there's a podcast in Pittsburgh.
Do you like to be in your basement anymore?
Speaking of basement,
we're talking about having a studio cat. Maybe
we're gonna move it to another basement. You should. There's a studio in this
basement.
No, that's a creepy basement we're looking at.
Speaking
but,
of basements, I was wondering if any of the folks are any start thinking of starting a podcast. Have we got any new people here thinking of starting a podcast in their basement,
well,
or maybe not?
Ours is actually in the kitchen. It's in the kitchen with Mary Mac. We're doing like a baking one because there isn't really
of you guys.
Anything like that.
Oh,
and
that's great. Niche
is,
niche is everything.
Video or audio?
It's just audio.
Yeah.
And then I, you know, it's just in the kitchen.
On audio.
Oh, fair enough.
There's not a face for radio except for Jim here.
who else
you
is
friend here? I know you had your hand up. You're starting something too?
Yeah. We're working on it. We work for a startup that's in the sustainability space.
Okay.
We're about doing something called Trash Talk.
Okay.
Nice. Yeah. So there's a lot of companies, a lot of focus on that right now. So there's a lot of content we figure we can kind of curate and talk about. Mm-hmm.
For sure.
Yeah. That's why it's so important, you know, like we were saying, to get back to that core of what you want to do and be spirited about it. Because you're right about the radio stuff. And the way to compete is to be that unique, you know,
niche.
And be passionate and build that audience now. And hey, the good news is when that happens, that means it'll be more ways of getting podcasts, more in cars, easier, because they'll say, we better come up with more technology. Everything we're talking about just gets easier, there's more of them. And by then, that audience built. That's why we raised the wild, wild west of it in a weird way.
Yeah.
Even though it's been around a little bit, it's perfect timing, in other words.
Well, and think about all the organizations and, you know, that need to know what you're talking about.
Mm-hmm.
And these people on their way to work are able to, and they're ahead of their colleagues. Then when they get there, think, oh, on Trash Talk today, I heard this. I'll present that as my idea in the meeting. So you know that's a
well.
Specificity is everything. That's why the baking is a good idea. Trash Talk.
That's why there's a million health and fitness podcasts, and like the Paleo podcast is 10x anything else.
Right. You know? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Two guys broing it up about the latest movies. How many zillions of podcasts are there like that? But what the guys at Epicast do on Does This Hold Up, they've concentrated on, we're going to talk about, do old movies hold up? We're going to look at The Godfather in the 2016.
And there's even several of those, but they have their own way of doing it.
Right.
Because there's a couple of guys that are on, like, a few communities that are on like the league that are kind of bigger, mm-hmm. right? And when I heard about Does This Hold Up, I was like, oh, that's just like that show that those guys are doing. But again, it's a whole different tone. They attack it a different way, and they just have a different vibe. Mm-hmm.
But it's just so heartening to see that people aren't going down that same track of the same subject all the time. You know, if I see another new podcast that's two guys sitting around talking about pop culture, you know, that isn't specific, you know.
Well, do you think it's getting oversaturated in general then?
I don't know that kind of stuff.
It's not oversaturated because anybody can do it. And quality content's going to rise to the top if someone thinks it's really oversaturated. It might be a problem with their content.
You're right, Buzz. I remember this old comedian said most entertaining show wins in a weird way, and that's true. That's why, you know, just be entertaining in your own way. If you're providing a service, then you be the most serviceable, but be the most entertaining, and you'll make something. You'll get 1,000 people, 2 people, 10 people, 100 people. I don't know.
That's
a trillion people. But you'll get somebody, and it's important. Every person you give to, it's important.
It took me a long time. You're exactly right to get to the podcasting game because there's so much crap out there that isn't good and isn't quality that I had kind of a negative opinion of podcasting, to be honest, until I started my own. And I started listening to other podcasts, and I found ones that were good and started listening. And you're right. I think that the good ones do stand out because of the crap that is out there.
If you get 2 people, it's important. Every person's so important. 10 people, you know, it doesn't have to be 1,000 or a million. Think about that. You have 2 people listening to you, tapping in, 2 lives, human beings, paying their bills, working, doing a shit. And they chose you to be entertainment. They're entertainment. So it's so important to just value all those, every one of them. So I think that's the euphoric thing, the spirit of it is performance and reaching out to people, whether it's 2 or 2,000 or whatever. You know, if you get more, you're like, wow, that's cool. But still, everybody's so important. And that's the spirit of it and the fun part. That's where, you know, the money, whatever, hopefully it comes. We're trying to make business of it. But the spirit of it is key.
You know? And you're specifically helping people with a specific need of specific information.
Mm-hmm. Well, I got specific. My next one's going to be 3 old broads in a microphone. I'm serious.
Hey, that's the beauty of it.
I got 3 over 60 creativity. Women, one's over 70, and we're going to talk about stuff, and we're going to encourage young people to call it.
Because the 2 old broads in a microphone market saturated.
3 old broads in a microphone.
All right, on that, I think we need to wrap it up, because I think you have to get out of here, right?
You
have to
wake up early.
Oh, come on.
Dang, 3:30 in the morning. I can't wait to do pocket monetize. We got to get this monetized so I can get sleep in next year.
Yes.
See, Jim, I actually listened to you.
There's nothing like pressing that microphone and being live. Like he was saying, it eats you. Mm-hmm. It eats you.
Oh, yeah.
I love the creative freedom that I have podcasting, but when you're on that radio, I mean, it's just that feeling that. That's why I think that I like podcasting, but I'm really trying to get into more live stuff on Mixlr. That's what I use. I don't know if there's a better option.
Do it live, be entertaining, and then put it on a podcast after.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, mm-hmm. Exactly.
Having that option, because you get to activate and have your super fans show up to that live and interact with you. Mm-hmm. And then...
Well, that's what I'm going to do. I'm hosting an 80s party in 2 weeks. And that's what I was going to do. I was like, I think I'm just going to go live and do stuff. I don't even know what I'm going to do yet, but I'm going to do it live. Because that's just that live aspect, man. Mm-hmm. It's just, there's something about it. There really is. I mean, I like editing and taking out the uhs and the uhs. But I like the live aspect.
Make it real.
Play Duran.
That's fine. Whatever your target is.
That real feeling.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I stutter and stammer. I even sing off key sometimes.
I like both aspects, but I like going live.
On that note, let's wrap it up so everybody can talk and everything here. And if anybody needs to see a tour, Buzzy's probably the best one to do that. You kind of live down there, so. real quick, everybody give their website real quick and what people need to look for them.
RiversEdgePGH.com and also the Rivers Edge on the TuneIn Radio app. 24 hours local original music and great talk content. So.
ProfessorBuzzkill.com. Mm-hmm.
JimKrenn.com. It was great meeting everyone there too.
ScareHouse.com.
EpicastNetwork.com or Epicast TV and Pittsburgh Podcast Festival this summer. Todd Glass and other people.
And SorgatronMedia.com and of course PodcampPittsburgh.com for everything coming up. We're going to have we have at least one more of these interesting ones planned. I guess I can let it out. I'm in the process of putting together a panel like this about social media and politics. I will not be on that panel, but we're hoping to get a few experts on there and talk about it, because it's been very interesting lately. So,
it's been huge.
Good year for it. So,
it's been really important. So thank you everybody for joining us. Thank you again to Pittsburgh Podcast Network, Academy Pittsburgh, Work Hard Pittsburgh, and of course our friends over at TEDx Pittsburgh for helping us get the word out.
Thanks, Mike.